In 1959, one man's passion for Jamaica and its music gave birth to the most diverse and influential independent record label in history.
It was a phenomenon that started with a phenomenal man. Were he not to have done it, the music scene, I think, today would be unrecognizable. Get up,
stand up. I mean, Bob Marley,
Stereo MCs, Polly Harvey,
Tom Waits.
Grace Jones is fantastic.
Black Uhuru there as well.
Sly and Robbie.
I'm really small.
I love that tune. My Boy Lollipop.
Amy Winehouse.
They tried to make me go to rehab, I said no, no, no.
Definitely Traffic. It was free. All
right now. Toots and the Maytals.
With Jim Cliff.
As well, Steel Pulse.
Trevor Horn.
Relax. Relax.
I'm completely obsessed with Nick Drake.
Robert Palmer, Roxy Music.
Top of my list, probably Richard and Linda Thompson.
Sandy Denny.
Fairport Convention.
Cat Stevens.
Sugar Babes Alike.
U2 has been a massive influence.
If you want to look at world music and the music of the last 50 years that changed the world, you need look no further than Island Records.
I really, really love music. I was living, really, for music. I love music so much, I just sort of wanted to get into it or be as close to it as I could.
Chris Blackwell was brought up in Jamaica, son of an Irish father and Jamaican mother, whose family had made a fortune from trading sugar, coconuts, and the famous Appleton rum.
You're always right with Appleton Extra Light, a rum of distinction. Product of J. Ray and Nephew Limited.
You got it?
With the firm belief that the right reggae artist could successfully cross over to a rock audience, Blackwell now had even more motivation to pursue his vision. The week after Cliff left the label, a struggling Jamaican reggae band called the Wailers, fronted by Bob Marley, walked into the Island office.
The three of them walked in, Bob, Bunny and Peter. They were so charismatic. They had a force to them. I just sat and talked to them for a bit and what they wanted to do. And I explained that really, you know, that I was an album company, that I wasn't really a singles company, and that I was definitely interested in signing them. But I wanted to position them really as like a black rock group rather than a reggae group. So I asked them how much they thought it would cost to do an album, and paid them £4,000, which is what they said they thought it would cost. I don't think we even signed something that day. I think I gave them the money and said, well, I'll come out, and when I hear it, we'll sign the contract.
Everybody said, look, you know, what are you doing? You're a Jamaican. You shouldn't be giving this man any money until he gives you what you want, you know, otherwise you won't be seeing that again.
I wanted to get their trust by showing my trust.
We had to trust him. We had to say, well, one good turn deserves another. And if he was able to take his money and say, go, guys, go put your tracks together, and I'll be back in 2 weeks' time or 2 months' time to hear what you're doing. And so we worked hard.
And I came out a few months later, and they played me this incredible record, which is Catch a Fire.
No sun will shine in my day today.
No sun will shine.
The high yellow moon won't come out to
that
play.
Yellow moon won't come out to play.
I said, darkness has covered my life.
He was surprised. He was in awe, like, are you guys for real? I mean, this is amazing, man.
I really felt it was a work of genius. I thought it was fantastic. I mean, the songwriting of it.
And so Chris said, well, okay, send tapes to England. Let me do some, put in a little crossover feel to start developing something new.
Island, at this point in time, was one of the hottest labels on the planet. We were a rock label. So we had to make it a bit more crossover. it was really just to try and way to shift it, because reggae music had no solos, whereas rock music had solos. So I wanted to put some space in and give space for guitar solos. I remember Bob being in England for the mixings, so at least he sort of saw it evolve. I must say, you know, he really put his trust in me on it, because it was changed a lot.
Bob needed that direction from Chris. He needed Chris's understanding with the production. And you know, people might think, well, what are you talking about? The man's got so much talent, you've made it. But not necessarily so.
There's a master move, but only like a Chris Blackwell could I think of. Because, like, the guitar playing on some of the tracks, mainly like Concrete Jungle, I tell you, it kind of changed the face of reggae totally.
It's very hard now to conceive of how unfashionable reggae was with the rock audience in the 1970s. It's not exaggerating to say it was despised, really, really loathed. And clearly, Blackwell and Island were interested in changing that perception.
Slave driver, you know? Slave driver!
Everybody loved it because it was so different. It was like a black rock act, but it was not like anything anybody had ever seen before.
Chris played a great part in establishing our music. He had no fear where Bob and the Wailers was concerned. It was evident that he was going to take these guys as far. The sky was the limit.
Despite poor initial sales of Catch a Fire, the album did receive favorable critical attention.
It seems as if you don't get the message. Oh.